whole thing that we're doing is like a big like skit or whatever. So like we're pretending that part of it isn't a skit, but really is. And just remember that if you don't encourage us, we don't encourage you. But what we did was we'll be taking Hamlet, the death scene, and kind of reworking it. And there might be some obscure references, but we think it's funny, so we hope you do too. And is that it?
I'm hit! my dear Hamlet Augustus, 1 point for him. I shall drink to my dear.
No, that's for
I mean,
that's for Hamlet.
This isn't gonna work. They're all dead.
No, it was not gonna work. so fat, and you're so skinny.
I'm so
fat. Thank you very much.
Okay.
You guys are in the next truck at least for dinner.
I know.
Yeah.
No, because when I was young, I used to go to Weight Watchers, and there were heifers who were like twice as big as you. Yeah.
I went too.
You went to Weight Watchers too?
Yes, I did.
Honestly.
Wait.
I'm missing
an idea.
What?
Are you thinking about
it? Oh my god. We do it at a Weight Watchers meeting.
We
can
do it.
Oh my god.
We should do it.
That is exactly what
we
do.
Wait, look at
veggies.
Fat. We have our veggies. We're
trying to make ourselves fat.
Okay,
it's
going to work.
Oh, okay. It's
going to
work.
Yeah.
Why not?
Oh, okay.
You
guys
are
awesome.
Okay, I'm gonna go hide in the corner again.
And I even brought my scale.
Yes.
Oh, that's great. That's amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, well, here. Okay, we'll have people weigh in and then they'll pay. And then I'll be the motivational speaker, okay?
You just do that.
Okay.
Okay.
Sounds good.
You ready, guys? Okay, I'm weighing myself now.
Come on, ladies. It's
no!
Week five.
Game five. Five.
No, it's okay. Oh, come on, you worked so hard. Think of all those candy bars you didn't eat. For me.
$3.50.
Come here. Okay. Do you see him right there? Okay. He reached his goal weight 5 weeks ago. He comes in here and eats those fat. Those backing sticks of death. Okay. He comes in and eats that in front of everybody else, makes them feel horrible about themselves, and I am just about to die. Okay? So what we're gonna do is we're just gonna kill him. Okay? So what you're gonna do, I have a donut, and I put poison. Okay? So what you're gonna do is you're gonna go and you are just gonna say, look, this is a donut. And you know he's gonna eat it because he can.
Oh my god, 135 pounds.
Cool.
That's awesome.
You little turkey. Yeah. He's gonna eat stuff because he knows this. When he eats it, he's gonna die. Okay?
Yep, that's great.
Do it.
Is it time to start the meeting?
Yes.
Where's
and you've been doing so good, Gertrude.
Where's the fat-free coffee cream?
The fat-free coffee cream? I don't know.
Let me tell you what I had to eat today.
Okay.
I had a half a cup of cereal with 2 tablespoons of skim milk.
You are so good.
That is amazing.
That is incredible.
Donut.
No!
No!
Don't do it!
Why?
No!
Now, oh, shoot. We were supposed to talk about cliches today, you know, all those overused. Today we're going to discuss art that was inspired by Hamlet. There have been many artists over the time period that have been truly inspired, and the most significant work that was done seems to have been of Ophelia. Now, four of the major artists that have done depictions of Hamlet are Eugene de la Croix, Arthur Hughes, Sir John Millais, and John William Watergauss. Now, all these four different painters had their own ideas and visions of what the best scene of Ophelia should look like. And so, I will show them to you, and you can get your own idea of what it should be. Here we see Sir John Millais. As you see, it shows Ophelia floating in the river. Notice the dark red colors. Now here, this picture is contained in the Louvre. It is by Eugene de la Croix. Picture also of Ophelia. She's lying in the river. Yet a third depiction of Ophelia doesn't show her dying, but shows her standing on the edge of the water, maybe contemplating death. And yet the last picture is a totally different view of Ophelia. It's a bright, colorful version of it, which is very different from the other three. Now, as you look at these, you see that there are different versions, different depictions. What does it all mean? Well, it comes down to where it's the author's point of view, or the painter's point of view, and what he wants to show. Now, this idea went from this single picture to the late 1900 versions of videos about Hamlet, movies that were made from Hamlet, and other videos that were made from the ideas of Hamlet. So, as you go on home this weekend, maybe if you can take a look at any videos, you know, it might help you in next week's art class. Thanks. Have a good weekend.
It's great to see the movies.
Skywalker's in love with his sister, and Hamlet's in love with his mother. No.
Gross.
Yeah.
How about the Lion King? Where?
No.
Why not?
Because the uncle kills the king, and the uncle kills the king and Hamlet, too. They're too much like Hamlet.
What? Keep away from him.
I think this is a job for
the Caribbean guy.
You like violence, right?
Yeah.
Hamlet's a school of violence, and it's been carried on in the present day. You can look at Hamlet and you can compare murder to all sorts of films that have been put out today. Okay, and there are three types of murder in Hamlet. The first one, you guys will like a lot. That's the one that's in the action films and things like that. That is the murder where the protagonist, Hamlet, has been wronged by someone, namely Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, and then he can overcome his conscience. His conscience says, you know, killing is bad. He can overcome that and wipe these guys out. And that happens a lot in movies, namely Commando and Terminator. And the movie I'd like to show you a clip from is Speed. The bad guy and the good guy at the end, and the good guy gets up enough nerve to kill the bad guy in the end. I'd just like to show you a clip from that right now.
Yeah. Kill him! Kill him!
the next one's going to be much, much worse.
Okay.
The second kind of murder depicted in Hamlet is carried on since today is the consciousness murder. Now that's when Hamlet is in his mom's room and he's talking to her and he just goes absolutely crazy. And he has no control. He sees Polonius, he sees someone behind the curtain, he kills him. He has no conscience, he has no idea what he's going. He's totally insane. And this movie, this kind of mindless slang has been portrayed in movies like Pulp Fiction and my personal favorite, National Horror Killers, I'll show you.
Yes.
Are you flirting with me?
Okay.
Yes? Yeah, I know what you're saying. Why is Dr. Wozmet teaching business? Well, it's an interdisciplinary thing here at Mr. So, today we're going to discuss the silkworm population and how the Chinese are able to get the silk.
Dr. Wozmet?
Yes?
I went to see a movie on the weekend, and it was Hamlet everywhere, and I have to ask you, the reason that they make these stupid recreations, is it to glorify Hamlet and for entertainment, or is it because of some business reason? I gotta know.
That's an excellent question, and it allows me not to teach business, so I'll answer. Anyways, it's true that lots of movies today are made more for money than entertainment. This is the reason why the actors are getting paid several $1 million just to make a film. Such is the case for the Hamlet version of Zephyrhallic Hamlet with Mel Gibson. Mel Gibson was paid several $1 million to make the film. And why was he chosen as the actor? Well, one, because of his popularity, and also because he has strong sexual physical appeal towards the feminine part of society. So if you add those two together, you're going to get a lot more people going to see the movie with Mel Gibson rather than seeing the movie with some unknown actor. Thus, people will go to movies, pay $7-$8, see the movies, and then maybe rent them again when they come out on video. And thus, there's business. How do you get on business if I was... Well, anyways, since we're on this already, why don't we talk about why we have to read so many books about Hamlet? One thing, in high school you have to read Hamlet, and most high schools you're required to read it. So you read it in high school, you think you're done with Hamlet, Shakespeare, and you go to college, and you're in Quest, aren't you, Mike?
Yes.
Okay, well anyways, in Quest, you have to read Hamlet again. Yes?
That's another thing. I want to know, why is it that if we read Hamlet in high school, why do we have to come to college and buy another
book? Well, that's where business comes in. Anyways, business comes in again when you get to college. First, I think that Quest makes you buy books by Cunningham and some other authors, and Hamlet's included in it. Well, guess what? You don't have to read that one. But you pay for it, but you're not reading it. But they make you buy another book. That's the same thing, just a different version, different style, and it costs $4 or $5, and you multiply that by the number of people in the room, and you're looking at $80-$100 for this extra book. And that's once we won college. So it's all, a big business thing anymore rather than entertainment reading in college. So how about we go from that and try and see if we can relate the book Beowulf or Grendel to Hamlet. And as we're doing this, I'd like you, Dwight, to step up in front of the class and really tell... Dwight, I wanted you to help me...
Hamlet is everywhere!
Thank you. Twice. Not. You're too caught up in society and what you've been taught throughout your life. Be your own person.
I want my mother to be happy, but that guy, in every way, he's in the way.
My recognition of Hamlet's intense attachment to his mother was important to my discovery of the ethics, which Dwight here struck me. Fate is that every child passes through a phase in which he wishes to possess the parent of the opposite sex and to be rid of the parent of the same sex. Now, Dwight, how do you feel about your mother's powers?
I want them to be out of the picture, but I'm caught between the desire to act and the ability to act.
Hamlet can fulfill his vow to avenge his father's murder and slay his uncle. He himself had abandoned his father and married his mother, and therefore he could identify with his uncle and only done what he wished to do. He could not kill Claudius.
To be or not to be, that is the question. To die, to sleep. Doctor, am I mad?
This way.
And so, to this very day, you can see Dr. Dwight Castro and the other West professors haunting the halls of Westminster and teaching their Greek history, their Renaissance, and their Hamlet.
Now we meet.
Thanks. I'm a Quest student who's pondering the question, what does it mean to be human? What do you think? Sincerely, what? Very interesting. Maybe I'll write this Dwight back now and tell him what he needs to be human from my point of view. Dear Dwight, I was intrigued by your letter, and it seems that we share the same quest for knowledge. I feel that there are many things that go into human understanding. Humans have always been in the search for knowledge.
English literature, explaining by English. This looks like a 17th century Romanesque typewriter.
I agree.
Computer science program.
Science and
environmental
and to fully understand humans, one must look at several viewpoints. I feel that mysticism is one of these viewpoints. Hundreds of years ago, humans looked towards astrology and fortune to better understand themselves and the world around them. Today, society mocks the ideas of these colors and gypsies. They feel it is unreal, but I feel that in order to fully understand humans, one must learn about gypsies and mysticism. To support this idea, let me tell you a little bit about what I know about gypsies.
Specialize in the art of fortune telling. However, since there are none of you that are willing to do this, I shall do it myself and tell you a little bit about myself. The first card, the Sun, the beginnings of Gypsy history. We came from Egypt into India, and from there we spread throughout Eastern Europe and Spain. By the 1600s, we had reached England and spread throughout all of Europe. You may ask, why had gypsies started to travel in the first place? Well, there's a story of gypsy legend that a long time ago, when Jesus was crucified, a gypsy blacksmith created the nails for his crucifixion. And when he found this out, he had had the last nail in his hand, which was to go through Jesus. He gave this nail to his son and told his son to run far away. To this day, the nail nor the son have been found. The second card is the moon. We signified a pilgrimage, an unexpected journey. During the Nazi invasion, the Jews were not the only ones that were exterminated. The gypsies, too, were taken into Auschwitz because of our dark skin and hair and our ungadgety-like lifestyle. This forced us to flee our homeland and into America's, including Canada. Our lifestyle. We tend to avoid contact with you, Gadgety. Many times it makes us ill to be exposed to you too long. In fact, they have their own set of dishes when they come to visit us to eat, because otherwise eating off of their dishes would make us ill. Our long skirts that we wear are worn because
our lower part of our bodies is murky or unclean to you. Our clothes and our jewelry reflect our status in gypsy society, and we prefer the most elaborate of each. We tend to work as musicians and craftsmen and support our families by borrowing from the gadget. We just don't return it. Marriage. Marriage is a special occasion in the gypsy society. Girls get married as early as 9, but no later than 14. There's a bride price given to the family as an assurance that the girl will be treated properly. In case of separation, the girl will not be left destitute. This new wife will now do all the chores and serve the family of her husband until a new wife comes.
As you see, Dwight, gypsies are still around today with their astrology, fortunes, and horoscopes, and they are very influential in today's society, although they may be marked. So to fully understand why I feel mysticism is important, you have to understand about the gypsies. Now, let's see, where else? For mysticism, I should tell you about the universities. Knowledge and human understanding is gained in universities by reading, study, and lecture. At my University of Massey College, we go about knowledge and learning this way.
Ensure you that you can count on me to do all
understand from what I wrote to you that in the universities you learn history, culture, and ideas of what it means to be human. You learn how disciplines relate and how past history relates to the present. Another viewpoint that I feel that you must look at while in the universities is the historical and literary mind, which may not be taught directly by the teachers at the university that you may have to research on yourself. Two of these great minds that I really enjoy reading and studying is Rabelais and Paracelsus. First of all, let me quote some Rabelais and tell you a little about
him. Hi, and mighty guzzlers, and you, oh, all you precious pox-ridden, I dedicate my writings to you. Shall I give you a little sample? This is from a book I wrote.
Oh, wow, look at
that. It's about wiping your bum. There's no need to wipe your bottom unless it's mucky. And it can't be mucky unless you haven't shut. We have to shit, and therefore we must wipe our arses. I say and maintain that there's no arse wiper like a well-down goose. If you hold her neck between your legs, you must take my word for it, you really must. You get a miraculous sensation in your arsehole, both from the softness of the down and from the temper teeth of the goose herself. Do not imagine that the felicity of the heroes and the demigods of the Elysian fields arises from their asphodel, their ambrosia, or their nectar, as the ancients say. It comes, in my opinion, from their wiping their arses with the neck of a goose. My name is Rabelais. I was born February 4th, 1494. That's debatable. Nobody really knows for sure except me, and I won't tell you. My childhood, same story, I won't tell you. Later on, I did become a Franciscan friar, and then after that, I became a secular priest. I studied all over France and became very smart, much smarter than you. I learned Greek, Latin, and of course, I was very fluent in French, because that's where I lived. Paris was not the thriving metropolis that it is today. I lived in Lyon, which was the place to hang out. It's one of the top six doctors in France at the time when I lived. I was not just a writer. And I wasn't paying much as a doctor, so I decided that I was going to write some novels, kind of like Michael Crichton. And so I started this writing career. And my books were religious satire. And I even wrote one, a treatise on marriage one time. That went over real well. All my books were excellent. Bestsellers, the masses love them. I raked in lots of money. Sorbonne at the time was they were kind of the Catholic powerhouse at the time. They didn't agree much with what I was writing. They thought it was very offensive. So I had to leave Lyon a couple times during my lifetime for protection. But I was never really in much danger because I had friends in other places. I even made friends with the king once. And so the last years of my life, just like the beginning years, are a mystery. Nobody knows. And it's rumored that I was put in jail. And I started a trend by dying in Paris, soon to be followed by Oscar Wilde and Jim Morrison.
Rabelais was a thinker who went beyond the normal and tried to stir up trouble and confrontation. With his outrageous and egotistical words, as you have just read in the quote which I've written for you, Dwight. Let's see. Similar to the Rabelais are the ideas of the great Paracelsus.
Reason is unity. All arts lie in man, though not all are apparent. To be taught means nothing. Everything is in man, waiting to be awakened. Hello. I am Thea Francis Bulletus Aureolus Bulletus von Holdren. But I like to be called Paracelsus, which means better than Celsus, who was one of the greatest encyclopedists of the first century AD. I was born on November 10, 1493. Unfortunately, I have a difficult time holding a secure academic position because of my controversial views. You see, I believe that disease is caused by external agents called silk, which attack the body and upset the temperament. Unlike these other doctors who believe that disease is an internal upset of the body's humors. Therapy should be directed against these external agents, and we should therefore use chemicals rather than herbs. And alchemy was meant for making medicine, not gold. all of these envious doctors begrudge the honor that I've won for healing princes and noblemen. They try to teach what they don't know. They're such vainglorious babblers in their wealth and pomp, but there's nothing more in them than there is in a worm-eaten coffin.
All right, come with me.
As you see, White Paracelsus himself liked to say contradicting statements like Rabelais, but he ended up getting kicked out of the university for saying some of these things against the doctors there. So by studying these two men, Rabelais and Paracelsus, I have developed an understanding more than one side, or the accepted side of the story. I was able to see how other people think and question similar ideas, but they don't get accepted because they are contradictory. Now comes the final area in which I think you should look at White. This one is more to the heart that you may even know about already. It is at the human person itself and seeing how they live and act and interact with each other. When studying humans, I think you should focus on, if I can borrow the words of Dante, the seven deadly sins of the human person. These sins are gluttony, envy.
Man, I really wish I had a donut.
Greed.
Give me that donut.
No, it's all mine!
Ah, yes, pride.
Damn, I look good.
Of course, we can't forget lust.
Baby, come home with me.
Hurry up! What the hell do you think you're doing with
that? And finally comes the last sin, sloth.
I want to go to sleep.
These sins are located by themselves or in groups in every human that is on the earth. And to fully understand what it means to be human, I feel that you must see and understand how these sins affect daily life, choices, and future ideas. Now that I've fully explained what I think one should study in order to fully understand humans, I shall tell you about my personal quest and how I decided on taking this route myself. I'd recently wrote a book, The Rebel Angels, and I've included in it everything that I think that it means to be human. I incorporate all these ideas, which I have discussed in this letter, and present them so that all these different viewpoints interact. In my book, I try to bridge the gap between the modern and primitive mind. I do this by setting being in a modern university with professors who are teaching ideas of the past, which are the Renaissance medieval ideas, and how they relate to the present. I also include the gypsy history in the book, since I am greatly intrigued by it. And I make it interact with this university, showing how primitive mysticism can interact with the modern knowledge and live in harmony. During this interaction, the reader gets a variety of viewpoints on the same subjects. They're able to support their viewpoints by quoting and reciting great minds of the past, like Rabelais and Paracelsus, which I had mentioned. The ideas from these great minds provide interaction, intersection, and discussions between the characters. In order to make the books humanistic and seem like it actually happened, I make the characters have some of the seven deadly sins, which make them very human-like and able for the reader to agree with. The sins of lust, greed, and gluttony appear most in the characters, and these sins provide for some interesting and surprising scenes. But I won't tell you about them now, for I wish you would read the book. Through the interaction between these characters, they are learning more about what it means to be human, if it is mystical versus the university aspect, or the male ideas versus the women ideas, or how contradictory ideas of the past can be made into accepted ideas in the present. Dwight, I encourage you to readily read The Rebel Angels and find all these qualities, and I hope that you attempt to understand the world, the whole world, not just here and now. This is the path I feel one should take in their quest for human understanding. Thanks for your letter. Sorry I can't write more, but I haven't been learning to go to. Sincerely, Robertson Davis.
Oh, yes, come in. There's a Mr. Brooks
nursing. Oh, yes,
Mr. Davies, are you ready to give your your sample you promised me yesterday?
You're not gonna tell me.
Oh, okay, sure.
Jesus Theater and another Baby Jesus production. Tonight's feature is a silent film, and the screenplay was written by Robertson Davies. Actually, it's not a screenplay, it's silent, so the whole action was written by Robertson Davies, and it's entitled Rebel Angels. Please enjoy the show. Thank you.
Thank you. Rob, I'm so glad I ran into you.
What?
Thank you so much for agreeing to take my class next week.
Oh, yeah.
You don't understand how excited I am about this teaching conference with international teachers, and it's just going to be the most awesome learning experience. In Aruba has a little something to do with it, but that's another story. Are you all clear on what you need to do for next week?
No, I just wonder what exactly is this group projects?
Okay, yeah. Today I'm going to assign them their final group project for their final exam. So all you need to do is just sit, listen to their ideas. They're probably going to have some problems and questions. Just go through it with them, you know, give them a few ideas and maybe you can help. And just take a couple notes so I know where they're at in their projects, okay?
I just one other thing. Would you be willing to take my education lit class in about 2 weeks on a Friday? I got tryouts for American Gladiators, the senior division.
Yeah, I can do that. That's fine. I really appreciate it.
It's fine. Just take my class.
Okay,
thanks.
I'm on my way to class.
Okay, I'll see you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Hi, class.
Morning, you too.
Hey. Julie.
That is so trifling.
Guys.
Whatever.
Guys, listen, okay? This is my time, not yours. Okay. You ready? Okay, guys. Over the semester, we have studied several texts from different historical periods. And I've tried to make it clear, Julie, that even the oldest texts have bearing on your lives. Okay? You can learn from these experiences, the experiences of those before you. Because every event, relationship, and word spoken is a building block to our present society and our lives. Literature is an especially valuable tool because you can see back into the past in their society-shaping views and for seeing how they connect to your lives. Julie, I've told you about that gun before. Okay, now guess what, guys? I have a surprise for you! Are you excited? I'm excited. Okay, you ready?
Are we going to go outside?
Yeah.
We're off to move.
Snowy.
Yeah.
It is snowing. Okay, anyway, give me my hug. Okay, today I am going to assign you your final project topics.
Yay!
Are you excited? You're excited. I know you are. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to group you into pairs, okay? Which I will choose because I don't trust you guys' judgment. And guys, come on. Okay, does anyone do this? Does anyone do this? Okay, I'm going to assign your group.
Excuse me. Go ahead.
Thank you. Okay. I'm going to assign you pairs, and I'm going to assign you each a specific research topic, okay? You're going to choose from the work that we studied this semester, okay? And you're going to make your connections to your topic. Yes, Andrew?
Is it really necessary to use works that we used this semester? Like, couldn't we use something we read over the summer?
I think we're going to
I think it would be just as valuable.
Andrew, we're going to concentrate on what we did in class, okay? That's what this class is for, okay? You're going to make connections to your topic from the book you choose and to your own lives, okay? Now, remember, I expect a full 20-page paper, in-class creative presentation, and a prepared discussion from you all, okay? But don't worry about it. You guys have 2 weeks to do it. You'll be fine.
Sure.
Okay, let's see. I'm going to let you guys go today, okay? And you don't have class. You're not going to have class the next two meeting times because I'm going to give you a week to get your ideas together, get your facts together, okay? We're going to meet back here in a week. Well, I'm not going to be here because I'm going to be at a conference. But Dr. Davies is going to take over class for you. Okay? I don't think Jenny's here. I know him yet. He's new on campus. All I want you to do is to discuss your progress and any questions you might have. He'll be a big help. Okay? Okay. Your groups are going to be, let's see, Bill and Julie, Tara and Andy.
Why don't you just write F on my forehead?
And Nancy and where's Becky?
I heard she was real drunk last night.
She didn't
come
home.
You know I need to discuss that in class, okay? Nancy, find her. I'll let her know what's going on and tell her that she needs to come to class sober sometimes because I need her in here, okay? Here's your topics.
Here's
you and Becky. Here's Bill and okay. I have a meeting now, so I'm going to leave. But I want you guys to stay here for at least a couple minutes and discuss your topics, okay? You guys have a lot of work to do, so you guys all clear on what you're doing. Alright? Okay. Okay. You guys have a good week. Have fun with your projects.
Have fun in Aruba.
Okay. Who told you that?
What's our topic?
Is religion. Becky's missed the whole mess of frat house. How is she even going to know about religion? I'm going to fail this. I cannot do this all on my own.
My topic is social life.
Oh,
I know
cool. That's your
But how am I possibly going to connect that to something I've read?
I
mean,
considering I
don't
really have
read books. Canadian, who is going to be nationalist about Canada? It's just like the U.S. It's the same thing. That's so dumb. I mean, okay. There's no difference, okay? They're both in North America. And, like, they're both in North America. They're the same thing. Like, why? That's
I can say we're going to have a lot more.
Oh, I'm so sorry, I'm really sorry. Okay, Bridget.
She left
here.
Yeah, she's not here.
Guys, I ran all the way here, and she's not here. What are we doing?
Give the newspaper religion. You're my partner.
I don't have a religion.
I know.
Okay, well, if she's not here, I'm leaving. Okay? Bye.
It's all in you. So I have
to go. Wait a minute.
Bye. It's like a whole big world thing, and we like to do everything about religion in there.
It's wrong. We can't like
Okay, sounds interesting. You might want to try it, but why don't you consider this? I got a title that I think might work. It's called The Rebel Angels. Hold on a second. I don't think we should listen to music now. I'm trying to do work. Yes, okay. The Rebel Angels. It's full of connection. It relates to religion. It relates to everything.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, I think so.
Like what?
I don't know. How about like the gypsies? Monastery life?
The gypsies are cool. Oh, I remember that.
I thought
religion
affects you.
In the New Yorker.
Oh,
yeah.
You think I read, did you? I found an article and it's really cool. We could try that. And
yeah.
You said monasteries? Do they still have it?
Yeah, there's some monks around. Monasteries, you know, people that live like that. Or how the church affects you and your friends or people around you.
Sure.
I don't know.
Okay.
Just take my suggestions, and is there anything else I can help you with?
No, thanks.
No, but thanks a lot for the help.
You're
I
welcome.
Have a good idea. Okay.
Really? It's really, really good.
You know, because you're the smart one. I can't do this all by myself.
Yeah, well, okay.
You have to do this for me, okay?
I'm tired. I get old in old age. Very rare.
They need some help.
They need help.
They come.
Help? What type of help? I mean, you guys look like you like each other. I mean, I'm not a sex counselor.
We didn't mean like that, do you think?
We have a project in the afternoon in one of our classes.
Okay.
Our topic is social life.
What do you have to do with social life? Looks like you got it.
Well, anyway, social life, we need to connect it. We need to connect it to something we've read this semester.
Yeah.
But you can't do that. I mean, social life, what is that? That's fraternity parties and, I mean, going to movies and maybe not, though. But fraternity parties, going to movies and, like, hanging out with your friends. And that doesn't connect to, like, what we've read. I mean, we thought it's, like, the books that we read.
Okay, what book are you considering to use?
We thought we would use the yearbook. You know, that has
yearbook.
Really catch.
That's good. Mine.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. It was like.
And I read that.
Yeah. We did. We had all the fraternities and all the all the activities and sports. But
yes, it does connect to you, but I mean, are either of you in it? Because I don't remember seeing your picture in it.
I'm photogenic.
Okay. I'm sure. I'm not sure exactly where you're going with this, but you might want to try the Rebel Angels, because I don't know what you can do in this, because neither of you are in it.
Yeah, we read that.
It's a story based on life in college. You sure be able to connect it to everything.
Sure.
You know, some of the examples I think that might connect to your life here at Westminster even is how like dating affects you and your friends.
She won't be here today.
Okay, today, from what I've been told, you're professor has informed me that you've been working on a group project for your final, and you're supposed to present today about this project and give the rest of your class a little idea about what you're doing, give them a little history of the book, or the book you chose. So, if you don't mind, will the first group come up? I think it would be Andrew Tinker and Tara McMullen, looks like here. You may have the podium.
Gee, thanks.
Wait, not old boy.
All right. Our presentation is on Canadian nationalism, and we chose to connect it to the Rebel Angels.
By Robertson Davies.
There's some questions that we had. One is, can anyone explain how the patriotism in Canada compares to that in the United States?
Why would he ask the question? It wasn't there. By the way, that was a real inconspicuous entrance.
They have a lot of same heritage.
Okay.
Good.
Okay. Okay. Good. Good. Anything else?
Yeah. I think that because Canada is a lot bigger and it's a lot, there's like people are more spread out, they love Canada more because they love it.
That was really specific.
Well, I was thinking about there's less diversity in Canada than there is in the United States.
Yeah.
They have more of a grasp of their past.
Yeah, because I mean, like in America, you can be, you know, people who are nationalists, they're like people who are nationalists, they were patriots, whatever. And then there are people who aren't, because there are people who don't share their same background, but it's a lot easier. Could anyone give an example of how this diversity is affecting Canadian unity? Could anybody have one?
I
know. Okay.
Didn't Quebec just try to succeed from Canada because they weren't happy with their Canadian relations and they wanted to improve their French heritage?
Yeah, they wanted to succeed, that's right. That's a great connection.
Yourself by your classmates or your friends. Don't
yeah.
Put them down.
Fine. What about Canada's reaction with other countries? How has Canada been influenced by America?
Oh, I know.
Okay.
Their culture, the like the entertainment industry, I mean, all the videos and all the rock, pop music kind of stuff, like they cross the border and stuff.
Sort of, but they have a lot of students that.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's true. Just being able to, like, lay out a conflict now.
Like, okay, what happened in the past 5 years where Canada and the U.S. and Mexico had a big agreement? What was that called? Starts with an N.
I
know. Yes.
NAFTA.
Yeah. So how is Canada's interaction with other countries, how would Canada be influenced? And if they have a trade agreement, what area would that fall under?
Economy?
Yes!
Yeah.
Oh, you're a ball drunk girl. Okay. But why do you think that there would
be so much... What's wrong with drinking?
Why do you think there would be so much effort by Canada to be like America in that sense? Well, actually, seeing as how I did research on it, prices in Canada are higher, and their dollar is worth less. It costs more, so they want to be like America, because they can get American things cheaper, they can get Canadian things. I bet you didn't say that. So, well, that's all for our presentation. So we'll next year go.
Thank you very much. You did a very good job.
Yeah.
The next group is, I think, is Becky and Nancy, and they're going to be talking about, let me see, oh, it's religion and how it connects to a book and their lives.
Okay, we're doing religion, and that's really, really broad, but we picked this really cool book, but they took our book. This is our book.
way they think about these questions, not just the formal way. Okay, my first question is, because in this book, okay, there's a monk, and his name's Parlablade, and he goes to the monastery, but he's not a very nice guy, and he decides that he doesn't like the monastery anymore, so he leaves, okay? But I didn't really know that they still had monasteries, because I thought it was like bad, like in the old days. But okay, why don't you think that more people become monks today?
Well, I guess the monks, well, when I think of the other teachers in college, they spend a lot of their time doing research and learning and things like that, and that's a lot like what monks did, because they would copy manuscripts, and they would just kind of do their thing, and they weren't real focused on, you know, anything other than learning and you know, God. So maybe the monks, they aren't called monks, but maybe they're a little bit like some of the professors, because they all do research all the time.
Do you think maybe that monks, like today, religion's not as important maybe in our society? And do you think that maybe people don't want to devote to what?
I think the laws of religion, especially Catholicism, don't really want to open space for new laws of learning, especially in science, evolution. That's one of the reasons why Parlablade didn't like it, because his philosophy was so different about life, and he hated how other monks to new ideas. And he wanted to sort of like connect that to Erasmus, because he was the same way. He would love new learning, and he hated being where they didn't accept it.
You guys think good stuff, but like I thought that maybe people didn't want to become monks because they would have sex. But that's all. Okay, question number two.
That's a good answer.
Thank you.
That's why I didn't come on.
Okay, we have another question concerning religion. And it's like, how do the gypsies' values and their ways, how are they reflected in today's society? Do you think we see any aspects of their, like...
You guys should really read this book, because there's a whole bunch of gypsy stuff in it, and they're really, really interesting people.
Yeah.
Well, I read horoscopes every day.
I'm gonna meet the man of my dreams tomorrow. It says so. It's so sad.
Yeah, plus you're all those crystals and stuff.
Do you play tarot cards?
Yeah.
Tarot, yeah. Those are really neat. Like, but they told me that I was gonna die yesterday.
Well, you see, that's
cool. Just,
and what about like elaborate dressing and even like shoplifting?
Because when I was in junior high, we used to go to the Hallmark store and steal Jolly Ranchers in our pockets.
But it's not the same.
It's not the same.
What about
but it's sort of like college though, because they went around from town to town and did their own thing. And I know my favorite part of college is road trips.
Yes.
Oh,
spring.
I'm gonna go to Florida for spring break. Isn't that kind of about the same thing?
How about their elaborate love of music too?
I love it. Right. I think the gypsies have a big bearing on society, because like I think today we are a lot. There's a piece of each of us that wants to break free and have some fun and be a little more outgoing than our outside shell allows us.
Kick off our Judas Blood break. Let's dance. You said kick off your shoes and have fun.
You didn't even kick off your shoes.
All right. Okay,
let's move on.
Okay, our last question, and everybody answer, please. Okay, how does religion affect you as a person? Does it have a big bearing on your life, do you think? Spiritual satisfaction is a good thing. Okay. I was raised to have big morals and standards and stuff that my parents tried to instill in me, which I'm trying to get rid of. It's okay.
I think that's what Maria is trying to deal with too, is that she wants to break free from gypsy stuff, and she has all these morals, and yet from mom, which shouldn't be even pushing them.
You know, I think that she's trying to connect her two lives, to her life and religion. Like
what type of odds it's meant to. And I try and learn what's believe in our religion at the same time.
That's true. That's very true. Anybody else have any suggestions? Anything you want to add?
Sorry, connections.
Okay. Our last group today is my favorite topic. Bill and Julie presenting on college life and how it affects us all. Hold on, let me get my shoe.
Okay. The first question that we were saying is about dating we came up with. But a big question on this campus is, do we date because we think it's fun or because we are looking for our soulmate?
You're
going to be... we said that it seems to transcend from high school, because all of a sudden it seems like in college people are trying to find the person that they're going to marry, and it's so much like the book The Rebel Angels, because in it Maria, all her mother is concentrating on is the man that she is going to marry, and that seems to be what this is all centering around. So,
yeah, I know.
Sure,
I needed that A in class.
Oh, I bet you did.
and then the immorality ties into religion and how you feel about sex. If it's, if you're that kind of person that you think the only way you can get a grade is to sleep with a professor, then
do you
professor
think
Maria solved
that
then?
Or do you think she loved them?
She wasn't being graded by all of them. I think she was honestly in love with all of them. She loved them.
Maria slept with him.
Thank you very much. These presentations were very good. I'm sure your professor will be impressed. I don't know what else we need to do today. I mean, if you guys want to hang out, you know, sit here and BS or something, I don't know. Discussion. Okay. Do we have a discussion?
Fine.
Okay. What are we going to need to discuss?
Why don't we ask?
Okay. This is Julie. Why don't you come up here? We can meet it.
We all
do.
I'm trying to get you guys involved. You just talk to us.
Hi, I'd like to welcome you all here to Full Tears Bar and Grill. And, you know, it's nice to see you all here. And before you leave... Before you leave, please visit our secret garden. You know, I haven't talked to you guys. I don't mean to complain or anything, but just recently I stubbed my toe on a chair and my nail on my toe started to come off and I just thought I was going to die.
Oh, young man, that's absolutely nothing. After what I've been through, my nose fell off, my ear fell off, and now it's hanged and then cut open. Let me tell you a little bit about this. Kind of all happened like this. I was standing here, ready to be hanged. My ear already off, my nose already off.
Let's kill him.
Yeah! Okay, I got the fire. Yeah.
It's raining, guys. We can't burn him.
I got an idea! Let's hang him!
Yeah!
Stomach.
Oh.
Oh.
my betrothed. When we were attacked by pirates, not only was I raped, but I was also violated, and then I was sold into slavery, and then I went to Algeria, where they had the plague. There was death all around me, but the worst was that they were really hungry. Get something like this.
Thank you.
Nobody appreciates me.
Big show today, we have priests who are in bondage
heterosexual named Voltaire. People who go to the bathroom over the railing. A 17th century sugar daddy who lives in a world of his own and sprinkles gold. And men who give more than just their time and their effort to their craft. But first up, our first highlight features a priest who likes to chain up people in his basement and whip them into submission. No, he's not just kinky. He tries to impose his beliefs on other people. He feels it's his duty to enforce his ideas on others. And this first clip from the Ricky Lake Show features a Grand Inquisitor explaining his views to the audience. Also on hand is a weird Frenchman who opposes such violence. Let's watch.
Tell us more about the Inquisition. Do you really participate in bondage?
It's discipline, it's not really bondage. We discipline people and we use physical means to make them follow the idea of the church,
okay.
The Catholic Church.
We have an opposing viewpoint. Let's welcome our other guest, Voltaire, who's promoting his new book, Candy.
This man is a stupid poo-poo.
He
has no right to cleanse my soul or any soul.
Let's take some questions from the audience.
So are you saying that just because these people oppose the Catholic Church and they oppose your ideas, that you're going to chain them to the wall and whip them into submission?
We first try to use non-violent means by talking them into it. When they do not agree, you have to use violence.
Okay.
Violence, you make them agree to the church.
Let's get some comments.
Ricky, I thought the show was about sex.
Is one girl sex or is it something else here?
It's a little more in depth than sex. I mean, it's religious. It's based on the ideas of the church, not sex. We don't believe in sex.
No. Are there any other questions?
Gives a new meaning to the term bonds of holy matrimony. Oh, I'm knocking him dead. Yeah, hey. All right. Next week on Ricky Lake, we talk to Francis Bacon. He'll be cooking up some pork products and other great goodies. Next, we have satirist and author Voltaire. He was on the Tonight Show on Tuesday, plugging his new book, Candide. Speaking for him is his publicist, Madame Chevalier. Time for a trip to the Tatsu. Unusual name board. All right. Here we have last week's entry, Ginerva. We also have La Donde, Transsexual Misunderstood, and Nyquilla. I think Voltaire belongs up in that group. Kind of looks right, doesn't it? Tuesday on Tonight Show, St. Thomas Aquinas will be on, talking about the wacky antics of Aristotle. Now we're going to talk about people who go to the bathroom over their stairs. I guess they don't need toilets. They're aristocracy. They can do what they want. They just kind of sit on the banister and let loose. These people also steal money from the people. Let's watch the clip.
Sorry, we don't have the clip for this one.
What?
We lost the clip.
Okay, wait, okay. We have people going to the bathroom over the stairs. This is good stuff.
I'm sorry, we lost the clip. The producer lost it.
So basically, we can't talk about the people who stole money from the peasants so they could build the Louvre and build their palace and live extravagantly while people are really poor, and we can't like make fun of them even though that is totally relevant to Voltaire and Candide.
Sorry, we lost the clip. I can't find it.
Okay, so basically they were beheaded, but we still have the clip.
Yeah, we don't. We don't have the clip back here. We can't find it.
Fine. Our next highlight features people who live in their own world. These next guests both are from lands which may or may not exist. In fact, one of them is from El Dorado in the Colombian Hills. We had a talk with Jenny Jones, and she explored the mental ravages which go through their head every day. That annoying French guy is there too.
All right, good evening, everyone. I'd like to introduce you to our first guest. This is Olga, and she thinks she's from Westphalia. Why don't we have a chat with her? Olga, why don't you tell us a little bit about Westphalia?
Westphalia is a historic district in west-central Germany. It is now part of the states of North Rhine-Westphalia, Northern Saxony, and Hesse. It is heavily populated and industrialized, especially in the Ruhr Valley and urban concentrations, but agriculture is still.
So what you're telling us is that you live in Germany, right?
Yes.
So why don't you just say you're German?
Because under Napoleon I, Westphalia was divided between the Grand Duchy of Berg and the short-lived Kingdom of Westphalia under Jerome Bonaparte. In 1860, most of Westphalia became a Prussian province, retaining a political identity until German reorganization after World War II.
Okay, let's take a question from the audience.
Yeah. My grandparents live in Germany, and we go to visit them every year. There is no Westphalia. You're making this all up.
Westphalia! You've heard it from the audience. Do you have anything to respond?
I'm not to understand.
Okay then, why don't we move on to our next group? I'd like to introduce you to Benito, who thinks he's from El Dorado. Let's chat with him. Hi, Benito, how are you today?
Good, hello. My name is Benito Santiago, and I work at Taco Bell.
Okay, you work at Taco Bell. Where do you think you're from?
I am from El Dorado.
And where exactly is El Dorado?
El Dorado is, the city is called Manoa. It's in the northern hills of Colombia in the Andes, along Lake Budovita.
Is it now? And I've heard legends surrounding this. Is there anything you'd like to tell us about it?
Yes, the culture is very special. We have mass quantities of gold. And during coronations, which I think is very interesting, we sprinkle gold dust over the new king, the new high priest.
Do you know, I have heard about this town. Is it true that your streets paved with gold and you think your rocks are rubies?
The rocks are rubies and many gems. The roads are not paved, but gold is plenty.
So what you're saying is basically that you come from one of the richest countries in the world that no one can actually find. And I have my question for you is, why do you work at Taco Bell?
I was born in El Dorado, yes, and I work at Taco Bell because there were no good women. I was looking for a woman, and I found one at Taco Bell.
Okay, finding love at Taco Bell.
I need to ask.
Yes, Voltaire, everyone.
Mm-hmm. These people are cuckoo. Mm-hmm. There is no real Westphalia or El Dorado. These are places I created in my mind, in my book Candide.
It It is there. I was born there.
All right. Now, our wonderful staff at Talk Soup, who spend so much money and effort on our show, have drawn up this professional map to show where they're located. Okay, now here's Westphalia. In Western Germany, you see France, there's sort of Spain. I drew this. Oh, I did. Okay. Here's El Dorado. As you see, it's sort of around Colombia. And here's Moron. I cannot believe that you drew that. Anyway. Thursday on Jenny Jones. Pre-op transsexuals and women who love. Now up, men who give a little bit more than just their time and effort to their craft. These men lose their genitals. That's right, they're castrati and they don't care. They're singing in the Sistine Chapel, they're getting respect, but they ain't getting children. We looked at the issue Thursday on Gabrielle, as she witnessed a live surgery with a pre-op castrati, Mondino. There's a line, and I'm not gonna cross it, okay? There's some things I won't show you, all right? I'm not that gross. However, unlike the castrati, we do have some extra footage. All right.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
I think that's the operation.
Yes. How disgusting can you be? Okay, I was just thinking to myself, okay, I need a career, so why don't I completely lose all ability to father children? You know, I don't understand it, okay? Finally, we're at our last clip on this disaster of a talk show. Do we have it on Leibniz?
Hold on. No, we don't have this one, and we're out of time.
So we can't talk about, like, most of what this book criticizes.
No, we're out of time. You got a minute 30 left.
Fine. Philosopher Leibniz was a philosopher who believed in optimism, that all things happen for the dead, that all is well that ends well, that all good things move towards some common good purpose. And basically, his philosophy was criticized throughout this entire book. Most of the characters who have extraordinary things happen to them and they come back to life, it's a criticism. It's a satire of Leibniz's philosophy. And we don't have the clip, so how are people going to know that?
You don't have time for it. You got 30 seconds left. Let's hurry up. We got to get off the air.
Fine. Thank you for joining me this week on Quest Television. I'm your host, Andrew Tinker, otherwise known as Tondre. Thank you for joining us on The Soup. Good day.
Of A Cent a Man. Today we'll be looking at the best of all possible worlds. And today we're in America, that filth-ridden, stinky, arrogant, egotistical, low-life, hillbilly, backwoods country. They had to drag me out of England kicking and screaming. I did not want to be here, so you better be happy that I am. Okay, so we'll be looking at optimism and pessimism, the good and bad in all areas. And first off, we'll be looking at philosophy of optimism and pessimism, and we'll follow it with satire, since we'll be looking at Voltaire's Candide. Now, Voltaire was a Frenchman who satirized the government. Now, if he was in Britain doing that, we would have hung. And I would have personally gone back in time and done it myself. So here, we will be looking at these two areas. And the first off, we'll be looking at the philosophy of optimism and pessimism through the eyes of a 19th century philosopher. Candide is a satirization of Leibniz's optimistic philosophy. Voltaire is obviously trying to make a point that Earth is most definitely not the possible best of all possible worlds. Escape greatly counteracts Leibniz's theory of poor philosophy that despite its imperfections, God has chosen of all possible worlds the least imperfect, and his infinite power has created it the best of all possible worlds. Well, since we have been exposed to optimism through one of the great optimistic philosophers, I would like to present an overall view of pessimism to one of the great pessimistic philosophers, Arthur Schopenhauer. Schopenhauer's pessimism in the world stemmed from his earlier life. He was constantly surrounded by death, losing his father, mother, and grandmother. He started looking at life as if everything was going against him. He ended up having no wife, no children, and no family. He was rejected by society, and the universities ignored his writings and beliefs. The world was evil, and out to get him. When an intellectual mentions the term pessimism, he or she automatically thinks of Arthur Schopenhauer. His name has become synonymous with the philosophy of pessimism. What exactly is this philosophy? It is a solemn, rational conclusion that someone draws from what seems to be to him or her to be the facts of his experience. The rational conclusion that Schopenhauer drew from his experiences was that evil existed in the world. He considered it the most salient, positive, and ironical feature of the world. Schopenhauer found great favor in pessimism because he found follies in the philosophy of optimism. This philosophy requires that life has some ultimate meaning or purpose beyond the mere perpetuation of life, and that people apprehend this purpose intellectually, freely pursue it, and make sure it is worthy of their thought, their effort. Being the pessimist that he was, Schopenhauer found no support for these requirements. He used the example of theologians. They relate life to some divine purpose or plan, guaranteed to be good, but they dare to suggest that these are the lessons of life. They speak of faith and things hoped for but unseen. Schopenhauer was a man that liked to visually account for his purposes, and he saw no divine purpose or plan in evil that existed in the world he knew. Another requirement of optimism is that there must be genuine and positive goods in the world that prevail to give humans some kind of hope and promise. Schopenhauer found this to be none true. The concept of summum bonum or complete and final good was simply and absolutely absurd. Schopenhauer felt that optimism is a bitter mockery of man's woes, and we cannot ascribe the theodicy of Leibniz as a methodical and broad unfolding of optimism. And any other merit than this, that it gave occasion later for the immortal Candide of Voltaire, whereby Leibniz oft-repeated in lame excuse for the evil of the world, that the bad sometimes brings about good, received confirmation which was unexpected of him. In his many writings, Schopenhauer talked greatly of life as evil. He made many connections life was that way. I would like to mention a few of them now. Life is evil because as soon as one is suffering from man to rest, more suffering is heaped upon him. Life is evil because pain is its basic stimulus in reality, and pleasure is merely a negative cessation of pain. Life is evil because the higher the organism, the greater the suffering. Growth of knowledge is not the solution to any of the evil in the world, for as the phenomenon of will becomes more complete, the suffering becomes more and more apparent. man who's gifted with genius suffers most of all. Life is evil and life is war. The total picture of it is too painful for contemplation. It depends on not knowing it too well. If we should bring clear to man's sight the terrible sufferings and miseries to which his life is constantly exposed, he would be seized with horror. And if we were not to conduct him, and we were to conduct a confirmed optimist through all the dark abodes of misery, where it hides itself from the glance of cold curiosity, and finally allow him to look into the starving dungeons of Ugolani, he too would understand at last the nature of this best of all possible worlds. Schopenhauer felt that the only way that happiness could be achieved in the world was if everyone was ignorant as children. Children think that willing and striving are joys. They have not yet seen desire and the inevitableness of defeat. The cheerfulness and the vivacity of youth are partly due to the fact that when we are ascending the hill of life, death is not visible. It lies down the bottom of the other side. I believe Schopenhauer probably thought that Kant was a good example of the existence of evil in the world, and how optimists tend to be blind to all the evil. Voltaire did an effective job of downplaying the significance of lightness in philosophy. He made it look so absurd and ridiculous to the point that he was gruesomely killing people and then bringing them back to life. He knew, as did Schopenhauer, that evil existed, had always existed, and will always exist in the world, no matter how optimistic someone's outlook is.
You don't seem to know how dangerous that the block can be.
I'm a fast learner.
Come on, this way. Oh, watch it.
Sure, people will tell you where.